I'm the second generation on this farm. My father and mother bought this farm in 1952. My daughter and son-in-law joined the operation in 2016. About 3-4 years ago, we built an interseeder that was just capable of seeding only, and we thought this was kind of dumb. We're going over the field and we're not doing a nitrogen application at the same time. So we really were dreaming about building a machine that could do both. This one here we just built this spring. I kind of call this an interseeder slash side dresser. What it does is it allows us to interseed cover crops between the corn or sunflowers or whatever we want to interseed, and also at the same time to put down nitrogen. You know, our previous machine did a fine job, but in trying to decide how do you carry the product to put on nitrogen, there wasn't a good way to do that. There's options. You could carry it on the tractor and saddle tanks. You could pull a tank behind. But we went with this machine because it's already designed to do the job. It already has the storage. It already has the wheel spacing. It's got a very solid toolbar, which has a great ground clearance. It's able to fold up very nicely for transport. It's got a lot of pluses that we really liked, and we were really happy with this decision. There's a lot of different ways you can do this. We're happy with the decision just because how it folds and how it looks, and it's very functional. This bar can drop way down and wherever you need it to be. A good clearance for transport. Our farm consists of pretty light soil, and we like to split our nitrogen applications on all our crops as much as possible. The first thing we did, we grow fescue for seed use for turf grass. And we had seeded it in paired rows using a drill here that's set up for paired rows. So we had two rows of fescue set at 7.5-inch spacing, and then we have two spaces that are empty. So that space that's empty, that's about 22.5 inches between the fescue rows, we came in and used this to interseed clover. So our plan there was, after we harvest the fescue, to have clover come up and improve the quality of the forage for grazing or haying. So that was the first use of this, but the primary use has been in the row crops. So we've done all of our corn acres with this machine and all of our sunflower acres with this machine this year. We've run about 220 acres of corn, I believe, this year, and about a quarter of sunflowers, and then we had about 60 acres of fescue. Hey, this machine came as a bare bar, no openers on it, so we've added openers for interseeding. We've got two openers between each 30-inch spacing of corn, and on each of those openers we have a hose which will deliver nitrogen underneath the corn plants. We like the idea of interseeding. We're on our third year doing it. We haven't seen any yield reduction to speak of, and we get a lot of extra benefits from cattle feed, and we feel the soil is improving. But we really struggled with the nitrogen application. We were just using urea or anhydrous. We didn't like anhydrous and urea. We needed rain or something to wash it in. Worried about volatility. So we wanted to switch to a liquid system. So this gives us the ability to apply a liquid 28% next to the corn row, which is less volatile, placed better right by the plant. And the cover crops actually can't access it as easily either, so we're getting better utilization for the cash crop. When we bought this machine, it was a bare toolbar. The nozzle bodies were here, but nothing else. The openers were gone. So we had to build brackets to support our openers, which are an older style John Deere opener off of a 455 press drill. So we had those openers we were able to get from a neighbor. So we had to figure out a way to mount them, and building the angle into them so the correct down pressure was there was kind of a crucial component. You can see the square bars here are angled downwards. That's to give adequate pressure to the bar, because typically these openers are on a rotating bar, so you would just hydraulically adjust them. We didn't have that option because they're mounting on a separate bracket on each section. So we built it with kind of a predetermined angle, which we kind of learned from the previous machine what that should be. The other component that's different is we added these nozzle bodies with a split on them, so they're going to two different outlets instead of one. And we're using a variable rate nozzle. It's a T-jet nozzle that allows us to run a rate from about 8 gallons per acre up to almost 30 gallons per acre. We got rid of an entire pass, because we would typically, before interseeding, I'd typically spray the weeds with a Roundup application. And then I would seed, and then we would go back and have to put a nitrogen application on. Or not necessarily in that order, but all pretty much done in the same week. So this allowed us to totally get rid of the nitrogen application, which is a whole other set of tire tracks and a whole, you know, just a lot involved. So this really streamlined our operation. Plus we made it's a bigger bar. This is a 30-foot applicator. So we were running a 20-foot applicator previously. So we can get a lot done with this machine. One of the modifications we have is what we kind of call it a wide drop. It's a way of placing the nitrogen next to the crop. These openers here have a bracket built onto them with a hose that is kind of directing the nitrogen towards the corn plant. and it's supposed to place it right at the base of the plant. Well, it isn't perfect because sometimes the corn is so small that the hose will push over the corn and you'll get nitrogen on the corn plant, which will burn it. So we've had to kind of play with the angles and the length of the hose and different things to try to place that safely at the base of the corn plant without burning the leaves. That's kind of one surprise, I guess, so far. We're pretty happy with it. We've kind of learned some things. We're running variable rate nitrogen. We do a lot of prescription mapping on our nitrogen and base it off of different testing, either zone mapping or grid sampling. So we're kind of running different rates of nitrogen, and we're finding that we're kind of limited to what we can actually do. The machine can only get down to about 8 gallons per minute, because if you get below that, your pressure drops so low that your nozzle bodies are starting to cut out, the check valves are starting to shut. So we need that minimum flow rate to get a good consistent flow. So we kind of had to modify some of our plans and put a little extra nitrogen out there just for that reason. We've kind of settled on V4, V5 to be the stage in corn that we like to be at. We also did sunflowers, which were probably 6-8 inches tall at the time. This applicator is built for this purpose, for putting nitrogen on corn. And right now it's in the transport mode, of course, it's folded up. These wings will fold down, so it's a full 30 feet in width. It's got a John Deere rate controller on it, which is calculating the rates that should be applied based on your input of whether it's a prescription map. It's also watching your ground speed to adjust the rate to the ground speed. So you're putting on a consistent flow. It's got two boom sections, so if you get to a narrower spot, it can shut off half the width. That's all controlled electronically, and you have a computer, of course, in the tractor that's loading the maps and watching the ground, seeing if you need to shut off sections or not. So this applicator is built for this purpose, but we have modified it to be used for seeding as well. This is a 1,000-gallon product tank. We put in generally 28% nitrogen in this tank. There's a pump in the back which pumps it through. We've got two different valves here that control two different sections, so we can split the machine in two. It's got a controller here which has a butterfly valve in it, which is opening and closing and allowing more or less flow through the hoses. So the hoses will be pressurized, come through here, get split out to the different nozzle bodies. This here is a check valve, so if you get too low of a flow, it'll shut it off, or when you shut off your boom, it'll keep it from dripping. We put a splitter on here with two variable rate nozzles on it. We have a range of about 8 to about 30 gallons per acre, traveling between 5 and 7 miles per hour. So these two hoses go down, come off a bracket here, which is angled. And these hoses typically are running back next to the corn plant, which might be here. So it's dropping the liquid right at the base of the corn plant. The plan is to get it as close to the plant as possible so it gets close to the roots, but to keep it off the leaves so you don't get leaf burn. These openers are modified with the down angle on there to get adequate down pressure. We've calculated about 50 pounds of down pressure. It takes about 50 pounds to lift these up from the right ground level, which has been adequate. It's not excessive. It's probably not as good as some of the commercial units, but it's working okay for us. Problems we've had with it is sometimes these discs will throw the dirt out too much and there won't be anything to cover the seed. So we've kind of been experimenting. Up here you can see there's some chains hanging up here. We've kind of been experimenting with some drag chains to try to hold that dirt back in to cover it. So we're still making modifications as we go. This whole toolbar is on a parallel linkage, and it drops right down to about this level when it's at the ground. So it's in transport mode right now. It is variable on the soil, but what really helps if you've got a good cover crop ahead of it, like a rye, a degrading rye stubble as a base plant is a wonderful seed bed. You'll get easy penetration with the openers. You'll get easy covering of the seed. Where you run into trouble, this year has been tougher because it's been so wet, and a rye did not really survive the winter very well, so it's been tougher. We've hit a lot of situations where the soil is almost bare and it's black and it's wet and it's compacted, and those openers are hitting that and they're just spitting the dirt out. That's not typical. It's not what we've seen the last two previous years, but that's why we're kind of trying to find a modification that'll work for all situations. But that it's definitely a benefit to have that cover crop existing between those rows ahead of time. So we had to build a pretty strong frame coming off of it. We supported it well. We got nice narrow tires running on 120-inch center, so we're not running over any corn with it. And we bought this Valmar box on an auction sale fairly reasonable. So this is an older air delivery system called the Valmar. It originally was used for things like Fargo and Treflan, that kind of thing, years ago. But we were able to get a newer style roller for it that was up to date, that would handle the bigger seeds we're using. We've got about a ton or about a tote capacity in this machine. And we plant a lot of things. Basically, rye is our mainstay, but we like a lot of different species in our mixes. There's a lot of years, you just don't know what's gonna do well. Our mixes typically include cereal rye, cowpeas, flax, radish, turnip, fava beans, millet, fusilia. Winter camelina is a new one we've been experimenting with. Just about everything. Michaela actually does all the mixings. And Benjamin and I did quite a bit of work to build this frame and mount this all in here, but it's worked out really well. The first machine we built, I put together really reasonable. It cost me about $4,000 to put that machine together with a lot of leftover parts and pretty reasonable stuff. This one here, we decided after 2 years, the investment was worth it, get more efficient. So we spent about $24,000 on the base machine here. We picked this up really reasonable, about $1,200 on an auction sale. So we don't have a tremendous amount of money in it. Iron, I suppose we've got $30,000 in it, or close to it, getting there. We're probably going to add more to it yet. We're looking at a blockage system. We've had a little trouble with some of the, it's got venturis going to each hose here. And once in a while, the bigger seeds will bridge. And we've occasionally had a plug. So we're thinking we need to put a blockage system on this so we can tell when we have a plug. Now, if we get a blockage sensor, it'll probably be mounted right here. So it'll tell you that your seed has been delivered, or if there's no seed here that it's been blocked before that, or sometimes if it'll plug in the opener, it might fill up with seed here. So it'll detect all those things and let you know. But under normal operations, that seed is going through and it can tell that and verify that you have a good flow. We'll probably have $35,000 into this machine by the time we're done, which we feel is a good investment because we're getting a lot of benefit, not only in soil health, but also in feed for the cattle. The crops look good that we've used this machine on. We won't know until fall what the benefits are. We've seen good results with the interseeding alone from the previous machine, but we have no reason to believe this machine won't be just as good, the same opener that we used before. What we're looking at here is an 1890 no-till drill, very common drill. A lot of these around, a lot of people use them for many things. This one's a little different in that we reconfigured the openers. A couple years ago, we put brand new towers on this machine. We put a new blockage system on it, which is an intelligent ag system. But the biggest difference is we rerouted the hoses. And the idea was instead of having one rank for each tower, like it typically was, where you'd have an option of a 15-inch spacing front and back offset, what we wanted to do was get a paired row. So we set it up so we have two rows, 7.5 inch from, say, the back rank, and the front rank would run the next two rows. So what we've been able to do with this machine is after weed harvest, we'll seed a biostrip. So we'll plant two rows of cereal rye and then two rows of a biostrip, which is probably going to be something like a flax, a radish turnip, you know, something like that that we want not to overwinter. The cereal rye will overwinter, the biostrip will not. And it will also hopefully make kind of a nice seed bed for your crop. So what we've done then, we've come back the next year and seeded our corn or our sunflowers or soybeans or whatever we have between that cereal rye into that biostrip. And it leaves a nice seed bed that has nothing growing, it's all winter killed, but you have that nice cereal rye growing in between it, which you can terminate whenever it's appropriate. It's gone very well. This is something we tried with a previous drill. We had a smaller 750 drill, which we blocked openers physically with cardboard or something to make it work. And it worked, and we tried it as a concept a couple of years ago. And then we bought this drill and we weren't able to get it done that first year. So the next winter we were able to make these modifications. So last year we went ahead and we did everything that way and we liked it a lot. Probably the biggest challenge we have is keeping things straight. We run RTK, but this drill is a toe-between cart behind a tractor that's running RTK, but there's a lot of movement, especially if you have any curves. And we're running, this is a 30-foot machine. We're still planting in 20-foot with the planter, corn planter. So we're struggling a little bit with row spacing, but we're gonna move eventually to a 12-row corn planter so it'll follow better. And we're probably gonna put implement guidance on this as well, so this will track better. That will be a globe monitor. We've experimented with it, but we haven't bit the bullet and bought that system yet.